The Argo Investment Program is great. Really, truly ask anyone, and they'll tell you the University of West Florida just does a fantastic job.
Man, that Argo Investment Program.
What are you doing, Joe? Can you stop talking when I'm talking? Quite frankly, it's rude. I'm trying to talk about how much I love the University of West Florida and the Argo Investment Program. They've really made investing great again.
Come on, man. Can't you just be nice for once and let me talk, Donald? I mean, we are saying the same thing. You're not the only one who thinks they're great. I bet you didn't even know the Argo Bond Fund won the national championship in 2023.
Actually, Joe, I did know that. Frankly, I know lots of things. And, you know, Joe, for once, you might actually know something. Finally, we can agree this presentation is going to be great. Truly the best. Get ready, folks, and try not to fall asleep like Sleepy Joe over here.
Wow, two presidential endorsements. Good evening. I'd like to begin by thanking you all for being here today. Welcome to the Argo Investment Public Trustee Meeting. My name's Erica Kyle, the Class Elect Portfolio Manager for Argo Funds. Our job is to manage the $1 million Argo Bond Fund and $500,000 Argo Stock Fund. It's the portfolio manager's duty to introduce to you the most powerful people in the room, our student trustees. First, we have Madam Ada Tarimas. She is our MBA candidate. Then we have the gentleman from the great state of Florida, Isaac Swanigan. Next is my favorite roommate, Ms. Lindsay Bumgardner. And last but not least, Mr. Kevin Van Dorn. You know, every time I say that name, I just think of royalty. Our faculty trustees are Dr. Richard Fountain, Dean of the College of Business, and the one and only Dr. K.C. Ma. It's my duty as portfolio manager to report fund performances. I'm happy to report that our Argo Stock Fund has had a year-to-date return of 13.69%. outperforming the S&P benchmark of 11.18%. Our Argo Bond Fund's year-to-date... Our Argo Bond Fund's year-to-date return is 3.85 versus the benchmark of -0.98. You don't have to be a finance major to know that that is impressive. Tonight, we'll be having three presentations followed by a debate. And of course, the real reason why everyone is here, food and drinks. We'll be having food and drinks in the back following the program. And as a disclaimer, these stock recommendations are for Argo Investment trustees only and not a recommendation for personal portfolios. Now, the rest of the meeting will run on its own.
What is your perception of reality? Is it the ability to capture, process, and make sense of the information our senses receive? If you can see, hear, taste, or smell something, does that make it real?
Seriously? How could you not know that?
I'll keep it real, but above all, I'll keep it on the DL.
Your quest begins now, player.
Imagine this for a second. One man with total control of billions of people's stolen data, all their secrets, their lives, their futures. I owe it all to Spectre.
We're entering an era in which our enemies can make it look like anyone is saying anything at any point in time, even if they would never say those things. So, for instance, they could have me say things like, I don't know, Killmonger was right, or Ben Carson is in the sunken place, or how about this, simply, President Trump is a total and complete
terrible day. I woke up early this morning to check if my new shoes I ordered on Amazon came in. But of course, they didn't. So then I spent the next hour messaging back and forth with customer support, just to get absolutely nowhere. Later, my Alexa went off, loudly reminding me that it was time to head to the presentation.
This is a reminder.
So I hopped in the car and turned on Spotify, which cheered me up a little by playing my favorite song, Yellow Submarine. But of course, with my luck, once I got to Davis Highway, there was an accident and my GPS rerouted me to take Scenic instead. When I finally got here, my phone suddenly rang. I picked it up, angrily asking, "Who is this?" But no answer. Now, I know you don't care about my terrible day, but what if I told you everything that was happening to me was artificial intelligence infiltrating my day? Artificial intelligence is changing the world we live in and growing at speeds that are simply unheard of. Its current market size of nearly $100 billion is expected to grow 20-fold by 2030. Yes, you heard me right, 20-fold. This brings the market size up to nearly $2 trillion. AI is already used in many industries, such as healthcare, manufacturing, and cybersecurity. AI can solve some of the world's most significant problems, like climate change, finding a cure for cancer, and even ending poverty. No technology to this day has the capabilities that AI has. Now, many of you are probably thinking I will do this presentation on a company that uses AI, like IBM, Microsoft, or Google, but that's not the case. I am not interested in the companies that are using AI. I am interested in the company that makes AI possible. My name is Luke Racine, and I'm here to introduce you to the only company making AI possible, NVIDIA. NVIDIA is the processing power behind every AI breakthrough you read about in the news. NVIDIA has leading tech giants like Amazon, Google, Meta, and Microsoft all relying on its technology. NVIDIA is the inventor and leading manufacturer of the GPU, or graphics processing unit. Simply put, a GPU is computer hardware designed to accelerate computer graphics. But the real value is in its parallel processing, making it ideal for scientific simulations, financial modeling, and AI. The company operates in three primary segments: data center, gaming and graphics, and autonomous vehicles. The first segment, data center, represents 55% of the company's revenue. In this segment, NVIDIA offers GPUs such as the H100 and A100 and cloud software such as CUDA. This segment enables tasks like high performance computing or HPC and AI training. HPC involves the usage of GPUs to solve complex problems like predicting the weather, simulating how molecules behave, and large data analytics. The H100 GPU is offering speeds of 3 times of AMD's RX, making tasks that once took years now achievable in days. 6 of the top 10 US banks, 7 of the top 10 US hospitals, 9 of the top 10 universities, and 10 of the top 10 US government institutions all use NVIDIA's DXG A100. This is because it allows them to achieve 20 times the speed for AI training. Now, I'm sure you're wondering, what is AI training? Well, AI training is like teaching a computer how to think, and NVIDIA's GPUs are the teachers. The next segment is gaming and graphics, representing 43% of the company's revenue. This segment creates the ultimate gaming experience through the GeForce graphic cards, which allow gamers to reach speeds of over 130 frames per second. Some of you may have no clue what I'm talking about, but gamers, you know exactly what I mean. I'm sure there's many of you that would kill for a GeForce RTX. Remember the release of Cyberpunk 2077? It's a game about the future. Of course it needs futuristic tech. Not only do gamers know, but so do miners. And no, I'm not talking about kids. I'm talking about crypto miners. Crypto mining requires GPUs to compete to solve difficult math problems.
and the unmatched speed of the RTX makes them the top choice. Now, the next segment, autonomous vehicles. You know how some cars can drive themselves? Well, that's thanks to NVIDIA. NVIDIA's Drive processes vehicle data to perceive the environment and execute a safe path forward. Now, this may scare some people, but honestly, NVIDIA's technology is more trustworthy than most people. Major automakers like Tesla and Toyota already use NVIDIA's tech. And trust me, more will follow. Now, let's get into three reasons why NVIDIA is a once and a lifetime investment. The first reason is the technology know-how. NVIDIA's RTX simulates real-world lighting, includes AI features, and is providing speeds 3 to 4 times faster than AMD's RX. Now, the speed difference may not seem like much, but for gamers, it can be a difference of life or death. In AI, NVIDIA's CUDA develops AI applications and accelerates workloads from 20 hours to less than an hour, making it an industry standard. And guess what? It only runs on NVIDIA's GPUs. The next reason is their first mover advantage. They invented the GPU, which now has a market size of more than $40 billion. They were the first to recognize the potential of AI as early as 2006 with the introduction of CUDA. In 2016, a decade later, AMD was still focused on CPUs and gaming graphics, making them a decade behind in an AI market that will grow by at least 120% year over year. The next reason is their top pricing. NVIDIA's H100 sells for over $20,000. They are able to charge these premium prices because the performance and demand is so far ahead of alternatives. The demand for NVIDIA's GPUs has soared so high that it has even caused major shortages. These shortages have led to gamers and crypto miners literally fighting. It got so bad that NVIDIA's RTX, $700 RTX, was selling for over $2,500 on eBay. And yes, people were still buying this. To top it off, NVIDIA will control a staggering 90% market share in generative AI in 2024. This leads to NVIDIA possessing the most powerful growth driver of all, the de facto monopoly. NVIDIA delivers predictable, strong growth. And in today's unpredictable stock market, this is beyond powerful. Now, let's take a look at the industry. NVIDIA operates within the semiconductor and GPU industry, dominated by itself, AMD, and Intel. In the next 5 years, the GPU industry is expected to grow by over 300%. NVIDIA has a dominant position in the industry with an 87% market share, followed by AMD at 10% and Intel at 3%. Make no mistake though, NVIDIA and AMD are the only two meaningful players in AI. Now, let's get into the fun stuff, the financials. For the last 5 years, NVIDIA has increased revenue by 168%. In the next year, NVIDIA's revenue is forecasted to grow by 58%. Comparatively, AMD is expected to grow 18% and Intel 13%. For the past 5 quarters, NVIDIA has increased its earnings per share. And in the last 3 quarters, NVIDIA has beat earnings estimates. NVIDIA also shows a strong earnings quality as its EPS closely tracks its cash flow per share. NVIDIA will continue these trends thanks to its profitable business model and ability to time the repurchasing of shares. NVIDIA is currently outperforming the industry with its gross margin. The semiconductor gross margin is about 30%. My company has had a gross margin greater than 45% since 2019. Now, let me give you some forward-looking statements. I estimate the market size of AI will grow by over 100% year over year. This growth will drive the global demand for GPUs to grow at a consensus of 25% for the next 5 years. To be conservative, for the next 5 years, I am estimating NVIDIA will enjoy a revenue growth of 15%. These estimates lead me to project that NVIDIA's EPS will once again increase, growing at 15% for the next 5 years. Based on these assumptions, NVIDIA's EPS will be 71 cents in Q3, 81 cents in Q4, and $4.07 for the year. For my first valuation, I used the sales-based franchise model, as sales are one of the main factors contributing to the share price of NVIDIA. I used growth rates between 9 and 13% and discount rates between 10 and 13%. Using this model, I anticipate prices to most likely be between $500 to $520. For my next valuation, I used the discount cash flow model, or DCF. The DCF is the preferred valuation for all cash flow generating assets, as the valuation captures the underlying drivers of a business. I estimate NVIDIA's free cash flow will grow at 10% annually for the next 5 years. For the next 5 years, the weighted average cost of capital, or WACC, is 11.7%. The long-term terminal growth rate for cash flow is 6%. As a result, the DCF gave me a fair value between $500 and $560. When combining the two methods, we can see that NVIDIA's fair value is between $500 to $550. At a current price of $457, this makes NVIDIA undervalued by around 20%. Finally, I want to add that I'm sure many people in this room already own NVIDIA stock. For example, Dean Emeritus Rinaldi. You've already seen over 200% in gains, and I'm very happy for you. Dr. Ma told me that you are eager to know if you should sell. But I'm here to tell you that I was taught to make exit decisions on valuation, not on cost base. If the stock is undervalued, it is a buy for everyone. In short, I would like to emphasize that because NVIDIA is a de facto monopoly and will take even more market share, because NVIDIA outperforms all its competitors in financial metrics, because NVIDIA is the only company making AI possible, I recommend the Argo Investment Program buy 200 shares of NVIDIA Corporation. Oh, and I almost forgot.
I would like to welcome you to the era of synthetic reality. Now, what do you see? You see, I would never say these things, at least not in a public address, but someone else would. Someone like Jordan Peele. This is a dangerous time.
Seriously?
I'll keep it real.
Your quest begins now, player.
Stolen data.
All of those were fake. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the power of NVIDIA. Any questions?
Thank you for the presentation, Luke. You absolutely made a passionate case for NVIDIA and AI, and generative AI, no doubt, is an exciting space. My question for you is, you mentioned that NVIDIA has over 87% of the GPU market share compared to competitors like Intel and AMD, mm-hmm. who are big names. You also project that next year their revenue will go up by 58%. Do you truly believe that these numbers are achievable or even sustainable? Do you think the growth has already happened, NVIDIA has already peaked?
That's a great question. Well, for market share, AI investment takes decades. You know, for normal technology, they say long-term investment is like 3 months. Well, for AI, it's decades. And NVIDIA is already decades ahead of AMD and Intel. So it will be very difficult for them to catch up. And for the revenue growth, this is exactly why, in my valuation, I used a conservative growth rate of 10 to 12%, and I still ended up with a valuation of around $500 or more.
Thanks, Luke. I think you did a good job articulating their competitive position. And I find it interesting because even after the stock grew 100% since the beginning of year, do you think there's still more growth?
Yes, I do. And one of the main reasons is because you should know that you should always make exit decisions on forward valuations and not on historical performance. And the 100% you mentioned already prices in the recent AI chip ban that we've had. And in the last 5 days, NVIDIA has grown 15%. So the market doesn't seem to think it's a big deal.
Thank you.
Magnificent, isn't she? 0 to 60 in 3.2 seconds. Fully bulletproof, a few little tricks up her sleeve. It's a shame, really. She was meant for you, but she's been reassigned to 009. But you can have this.
I know you guys were thinking, but no, I'm not the new James Bond. I can definitely see James Bond driving the new BYD HAN 2023. If that were to happen, it wouldn't surprise me one bit. After all, electrical vehicles are the way of the future. My name is Miauke, Nicolas Miauke. I'm here today to introduce you to the largest electrical vehicle maker of the world. And no, I'm not talking about Tesla, as probably everybody here is expecting. The company I'm talking about has sold more vehicles than anyone in the world. The company I'm talking about produces electrical batteries. The company I'm talking about has entered into a partnership with the top selling automakers, that is Toyota. Now, you definitely think I'm talking about Tesla, but no, that's not the case. The company I'm referring to is none other than BYD, headquartered in Shenzhen, China. BYD is known for making rechargeable batteries as well as electric cars, buses, and trucks. Last year alone, BYD sold almost 1.8 million vehicles, which is more than anyone in the world. Let me tell you why BYD cars are so unique. Let's say you have $30,000 to spend on an electrical vehicle. Would you rather buy a Nissan Leaf for $28,000 with a range of 150 miles, or a Tesla Model 3 for $39,000 with a range of 333 miles? Or a BYD Seal for $26,000 with a range of 350 miles. Well, no, you can even buy a Tesla Model 3 for $30,000. And if you could buy something, it would be a Nissan Leaf, but with only 150 miles. The good news is that you can buy a BYD Seal for $26,000. I'm not here today to recommend your stock because this is an affordable car. I'm going to give you the three real reasons why I think BYD is a good investment. First off, you're looking at the largest vehicle maker in the world. The Chinese auto market accounts for over half of all electrical vehicles sold. BYD already owns about 18% of the global market share, compared with Tesla, that only has 13%. The best part is that the Chinese government has already given the best gift you could imagine. They have passed a mandate which states that by 2030, at least 40% of all of their cars must be electric. Okay, let's do this together. It is expected that China will sell 66 million cars by 2030, of which 40% must be electric. BYD has 18% market shares. That means that they will have about 4.75 million cars to sell. The second reason is that BYD is the only electrical vehicle manufacturer who produces its own batteries. BYD has been making batteries since 1995. And as of 2023, BYD has sold 1.8 million electrical vehicles. Therefore, that makes them the single largest EV maker. To give you some perspective, Tesla is in the process of building a factory to start producing more batteries. But Tesla still has to import most of their batteries from Panasonic. You see, the electrical vehicle battery making industry is not easy to enter, as it requires heavy capital expenditure. Unlike BYD, these other companies rely on external manufacturers to produce their batteries. BYD has taken the approach of producing both EV batteries and automobiles. This approach is more cost and time efficient. Now, let's talk about another advantage that BYD has. According to UBS study, BYD has 75% of their components made in China. This is why they can maintain a 25% lower cost compared to the models that are being produced by their competitors. This lower cost gives BYD a clear advantage over other EV makers. That's why my expectation for BYD is a 19% gross margin compared to Tesla's, that is 8.4%. Others are trying to mimic what BYD is doing. However, entering the battery industry is not an easy process, and I don't see anyone competing with them in the near future. My last reason is the global shift towards an emission-free planet. 2 years ago, electrical vehicles accounted for only 4.2% of the total car sales around the world. By 2040, there will be over 700 million electrical vehicles on the road. Therefore, 46% of all cars will be electric. To be honest, I'm more excited about the industry these companies in now more than ever. Some of you might think the EV is something that goes up and then goes down. You might ask, why this time is any different? My answer to that is that we are in a unique era. Nowhere in history has the EV market sold over 10 million vehicles. Nowhere in history has the government passed a mandate that we must have electric vehicles. Nowhere in history has the EV market grown so quickly. For example, the electrical vehicle shares are expected to reach 21% by 2025 and 37% by 2030. The electrical vehicle market size was valued at $49.1 billion in 2022 and $1 trillion by 2030. The Asian Pacific market is projected to have the fastest growth. It's already up 28% for the year of 2023. Europe is 21%. And North America is up 10%. Being located in China is a major advantage to my company. Their home is considered the fastest growing region of the EV market. I just told you about the growth of the industry. Now, let me tell you about the growth of the company. BYD has entered an agreement with Toyota, one of the largest automakers in the world. Together, they will be making electrical sedans and SUVs. My company will provide Audi's batteries for their premium electrical vehicle line. The industry this company is in has a massive global demand. Governments around the world, such as Netherlands and India, will only allow sales of electrical vehicles by 2030. Now, let's get into the exciting stuff, the financials. BYD currently has 18% market share, which was 7% in 2017. Unlike Tesla, they have the production capacity to produce about 2.9 million vehicles, and they continue to expand. My company has doubled their revenue between 2021 and 2022, and increased another 50% from 2022 to 2023. Earnings per share also increased from 33 cents to $1.70. That's over 516% increase only from 2021 to 2022. BYD is currently outperforming the automotive industry with its gross margin of 22%. The average automotive industry has a margin of 16.8%. My company outperforms the average by 5%. Let me give you some forward-looking statements. Hopefully, the trade war will disappear over the time. China's new vehicle mandate will start to kick in, to increase. China's demand for electrical vehicles will go up. Remember, Chinese EV demand represents more than half of the global EV demand. The industry will grow at consensus of over 10%. To be conservative, I'm estimating a growth rate for BYD at 18%. Based on those assumptions, I expect total electric vehicles demand to be about 20 million by 2025. Combined with the long-term growth rate and a rising growth margin over 18.5%. I also forecast BYD shares of the EV market. Demand for BYD shares will be approximately 6 million in 2023. This will bring my company global market share to nearly to 40%. Based on those assumptions, I estimate that EPS will be $2 for quarter four, $1.25 for quarter one, and $4 for the fiscal year of 23, and $5 for the fiscal year of 24. For my valuation, I use the franchise model. Revenue-based models are appropriate for the automotive industry. I use revenue growth rate between 15% and 25%, and a range discount rate between 15% and 20%. Using this model, I will evaluate BYD shares between $75 and $80 at the current price of $62. BYD stock is undervalued by 20%. In short, I would like to emphasize that because BYD has the largest EV market share, because the industry will take off growing at 22%, and because BYD surely will recover from the trade war, I recommend the Argo Investment Program to buy 1,000 shares of BYDDY. Questions?
Okay, first of all, Nicholas, wonderful job on your presentation. You did a wonderful job with that. And I just have a quick question on, will the trade war going on right now between US and China impact BYD at all?
So the trade war will not impact China because most of China's cars are not selling in the United States. I don't see China selling any cars in the near future in the United States. If any case, the worst scenario can happen and the United States would try to hurt Tesla at BYD, it will happen the same with China. China will retaliate and try to attack Tesla. Remember, Tesla has 10% of the market shares in China. So if United States tries to do something, they will get hurt as well.
Thank you, Miele, Nicholas Miele. Definitely I'm excited by BYD, especially due to its global reach. I'm also very impressed by the 25% lower cost structure due to their 75% local supply and production. But because of their pricing power, I can foresee problems with the EU. EU is threatening to start an investigation about their pricing, may impose an import tariff on BYD's cars. So there's a whole lot of tariff wars that can go there. This would significantly, obviously, impact the future revenues of BYD on the global scale. Do you think this is a major risk that BYD will face? Can you just add more color to the major risks with the tariffs that BYD can face?
Definitely. That was a good question, by the way. So not all of the European countries are in favor of EU imposing tariffs in China, such as the president of France, the prime minister of Germany. They know that if they impose tariffs in China, China will retaliate as well. Just so you have a nonsense, last year alone, Germany sold around 6 million vehicles in China. So, you know, both of them are going to get hurt, not just China.
Thank you.
More questions? No.
You guys too easy on them, huh?
Look at me. 미르나. 미르나. 미르나!
Did you know that in the last 250 years, the United States had only 15 years not involved in war? Did you know that the world has been at war for over 90% of the last 4,000 years? Let's just face it, war is inevitable. War kills innocent people, war prevents fathers from coming back to their children, and husbands to their wives. War keeps families from being together. War is destructive. We cannot escape the war's destruction, but we can make wars more humane. My name is Pedro Ganachan Barros Pili, and I'm here to introduce you to the concept of unmanned weaponry, technology that will allow soldiers to fight without leaving their families. Kratos Defense and Security Solution is a defense technology company. Kratos serves governments and commercial clients in the defense industry. The company has two segments, government solutions and unmanned systems. And it also has six divisions of products and services: space training and cybersecurity, defense and rocket support services, microwave electronics, turbine technologies, C5ISR systems, and unmanned systems. The one that interests me the most is the unmanned systems division. This division is already responsible for 1/3 of Kratos' revenue, and it makes three main types of products: tactical UAVs that are unmanned aerial vehicles, such as their combat drones, small UASs, which are small remote control drones, and aerial targets for weapon testing and military training. Now that you know more about my company, let me tell you three reasons why we want to invest in Kratos. Firstly, we want to invest in the area of unmanned warfare. And if you bear with me, you'll see why. During the first 16 months of war in Ukraine, only 160 airplanes and 120 helicopters were lost. On the other hand, for that same period, over 90,000 drones were lost. The difference? Drones do not need pilots inside them. Actually, I'm gonna make this more clear. If 95,000 drones were aircrafts fitting two people each, there would have been another 190,000 lives lost. Had these not been drones, the death total would have doubled. And if these had not been in the air, missile against missile, if it wasn't for an unmanned system, we would have lost a couple thousand of lives in only a couple of minutes. The second reason we want to invest in Kratos is that the defense industry has a guaranteed demand for the next whole decade. Poland Prime Minister said they will no longer transfer weapons to Ukraine. The British Defense Committee said it will take 10 years to replace weapons given to Ukraine during the war. The French Parliament reported that orders for new ammunition would take up to 36 months to be delivered. The United States would take 13 years only to replace the missiles sent to the war. And even Russia had to start asking North Korea and Iran for supply of their war weaponry. They're all telling us there's a big shortage on weaponry supply for the years to come. And what other industry can you name that has a guaranteed demand for at least the next decade? The third reason is that Kratos is virtually focused on the defense industry. For this industry, Kratos is a pure player. I'm gonna put that way for you. Think of these three companies: GE, Airbus, and Boeing. GE, only 28% of their revenue comes from defense contracts. Airbus, only 19%. And Boeing, that you might be thinking to be the biggest one, only 30% of the revenue comes from defense contracts. But Kratos, 100% of their revenue comes from this industry. And if we want to benefit from the potential of this industry, we have to be all in. To understand more about the potential of this industry, let's zoom out and look at the bigger picture. This year alone, the United States increased their defense budget by over 20%. This year, the defense industry will grow 6.3%. This year, the combat drone sector will grow 8.6%. This growth is driven by over $100 billion spent in support of Ukraine. This growth is driven by an extreme scarcity on the supply of weapons worldwide. Now, let me tell you about my company's financials. My company had an annual revenue growth rate of 8% in the past 5 years, while their competitor, Northrop Grumman, grew only 5% for the same period. For gross margin, for the last 5 years, the industry averaged around 20%. Kratos has 26%. Northrop Grumman, 18%. Their adjusted earnings per share in 2022 is 31 cents and 36 cents for fiscal year 2023, which is a 16% increase. But let me give you some forward statements that will turn tables around for Kratos. For 2023, Kratos should see an increase of $200 million in revenues and reach the $1 billion mark. That is an 11.3% increase from last year's revenue. It will get even better. For the next 5 years, my company revenue will reach double-digit growth rate with an average of 13.7% year over year. More importantly, Kratos unmanned segments had an annual revenue of about $222 million in 2022, representing 33% of the company's total revenue. But by 2028, the unmanned segment will make up at least 50% of the total revenue, which is a 150% increase. In short, for the next few years, given that the industry revenue will grow around 6.3% a year, Kratos will grow around 13%, and their margin will reach 29%. I estimate that Kratos' EPS will be 12 cents in Q3, 10 cents in Q4, and 36 cents for the fiscal year of 2023. In the next few years, I expect Kratos' EPS to grow over 168% and reach $0.68 in 2025. For my valuation, I used a discount cash flow model. A DCF estimates the company's value by summing all the cash flows and discounting them by the weighted average cost of capital, or WACC. To find Kratos' fair value, I projected cash flow for the next 5 years to be about 10% and the company with a WACC of 9.2%. For my terminal growth rate, I used it 6%. As a result, I valued Kratos between $20 and $22 a share. That's an undervaluation of 25% compared to their current price of $17. Although my price is a little bit higher than the street's estimates at $19, I am confident that my target price will be reached, especially with the surprise breakout of the recent war. In conclusion, the defense industry will have a guaranteed demand for the next decade. And as a pure player, Kratos will benefit from that boom. And Kratos' unmanned segment will grow over 150% in the next few years. Therefore, I recommend to buy 2,500 shares of Kratos. But hold on.
Laser armed. Sensor and thermal confirmed. I don't want to wait on her. We're going to have to come around.
How far are you from Bingo Fuel?
20 minutes on station.
Better get on it.
Where are we?
30 seconds. Go, he's moving now.
Not for long.
Target destroyed.
Any questions?
Hey, Pedro, you had a great presentation. I appreciate that you pointed out there was a global shortage of arms. And my question is whether the government should just make the arms themselves compared to just relying on the private sector for arms.
Yeah. I don't think the governments will do that, and my response is based on an analysis of the industry. So if you see creators, for example, over 60% of the revenue is coming from government contracts. If you get the other ones, for example, Boeing, 30% of the revenue is coming from government contracts. And Boeing has a market share on the defense revenue budget, of over 10%. So it shows us that the history of the industry, governments are relying on the private sector to make their weapons. So based on that, I don't believe they are going to be shifting to making their own weapons.
Unbelievable work, Pedro. I was really impressed. I know you worked really hard with Dr. Ma and the other students on these presentations, and you can take a deep breath knowing that your hard work has paid off. So congratulations to you.
Thank you.
I do have a quick question, though. With your recommendation involving a premier defense solutions provider, and we know the war in Ukraine has been going on for over a year and a half now, what can you say about the markets kind of already pricing in the expected demand for new weapons, new weapon systems, and of course these unmanned drones?
Yep. I think the market has priced the Ukraine war just because it's been here for a while. It's been here for over a year, so the market had the ability to price it already. But I don't believe the market has priced the current war in the Middle East. And I truly believe that's going to make prices of the defense industry skyrocket. Any more questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great things have small beginnings. Every partnership. Every city we call home. Tapping, swiping, tracking, trading, hodling, sharing, and creating.
You were living a pretty normal life, and then things changed in an instant.
In the traditional system, getting this money would have taken weeks through donors and transfers, but with crypto, it's like instantaneous.
Nobody, I don't care if you're Warren Buffett or if you're Jimmy Buffett, nobody knows, because it's going to go up, down, sideways, in circles. It's all a fugazi. You know what a fugazi is?
Fugazi. It's a fake.
Yeah, fugazi, fugazi. It's a wazi, it's a woozy, it's a... fairy dust. It doesn't exist. It's never landed. It is no matter. It's not on the elemental chart. It's not real.
Right? It's absurd. It's just the wrong way to invest. It always has been. It always will be.
This is one of the biggest financial frauds in American history.
Fraud is fraud. It does not matter the complexity of the investment scheme. It does not matter the amount of money in.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Elon Musk. Don't worry, I am not running for president, at least not yet. I am running the debate. Before I begin, I would like to thank the University of West Florida and Dean Fountain for having me. Oh, I see Coach Derek Racine, and there sure are a bunch of deans here tonight. Dean Emeritus Ranelli, Dean Emeritus O'Keefe, Dean Melissa Broad are here, just to name a few. Oh, even Ashton Haywood is in the house too. Hello, guys. Tonight we have Mr. Robert Sherlock and Mr. Aaron Correll here to debate a very exciting topic about cryptocurrency. Mr. Sherlock, you will have the opportunity to answer first, followed then by Mr. Correll's response. All right, let's begin. The first question is cryptocurrency the future? Mr. Sherlock, you have the floor.
Thank you, Elon. But what do you mean the future? Crypto is already here. In fact, if I were to ask the room, I bet half of the audience here owns some form of crypto. And that leads me to my first point tonight. Crypto is the future. Crypto has established itself as a form of currency. It meets the three functions of money: a medium of exchange, a store of value, and a unit of measure. But first, let me explain the technology behind cryptocurrency. Blockchain. Blockchain is a virtual record book that cannot be altered. Imagine a piece of paper. Blockchain tears this piece of paper into microscopic pieces, so small that it is impossible to put the pieces back together. Then it spreads it across every device on the network. The only way you can put it back together is with the proper key. This makes blockchain files unalterable and accessible anywhere on the internet. And that leads me to my first application, decentralized finance, or DeFi, which already has a market of $13 billion. Decentralized finance eliminates the need for banks or any third party, reducing transaction time from 3 days to as little as 25 minutes. DeFi is the new way of banking, allowing crypto to act as a means of exchange. Which leads me to the next application, data oracles. I am talking about the middleman between the blockchain and the real world. Without oracles, blockchains are like computers without internet connection. The leading data oracles network, Chainlink, has facilitated over $6 trillion in total transaction value. Better yet, companies such as AccuWeather use these oracles to create smart contracts on the blockchain. Oracles give crypto the means to act as a unit of measure. Ladies and gentlemen, this next application turns real-life assets into replicated digital assets on the blockchain. I am talking about asset tokenization. These assets include stocks, bonds, property rights, and even individual identities. These tokens cannot be replicated because each token is given a unique identification code. This is a market that is worth north of $3 billion and is increasing by 23% a year. Tokenization creates a store of value by backing it with assets. An example of this tokenization is the so-called stablecoin. Stablecoins are cryptocurrencies that's value is tied to another currency or an asset, such as the US dollar or gold. Stablecoins eliminate volatility and allow for a safer way of investing. In short, not only does crypto meet the three functions of money, but blockchain technology is the future of finance.
Thank you, Mr. Sherlock. I like your asset tokenization point. Now, moving on to Mr. Coral, what is your response?
Elon, thank you for the opportunity to be here, and I'll try to answer your question a little bit more succinctly than Mr. Sherlock here. To start, I want to dispute the idea that crypto is a currency. In order to be a currency, it has to fulfill three roles. Currently, Bitcoin, the most popular crypto, for example, fails at all three. For the first function, a medium of exchange. At the moment, only 1% of businesses worldwide accept it as a form of payment. A store of value. Cryptos lack intrinsic value and have no backing reserves or price stabilization mechanisms. This makes them inherently volatile and unsuitable as a means of payment. Bitcoin exhibits volatility levels 4 times higher than stocks and has a history of dropping over 20% in one day. Such high volatility means that households cannot rely on crypto as a store of value. Firms cannot use crypto as a unit of account for the calculations of the prices on their balance sheet, which means it fails all three functions of money. As for blockchain technology, let me remind you, Robert, this has long been implemented. For example, you conveniently left out the US government's FedNow program and real-time payments, where you can perform those same instantaneous transactions in real dollars. With respect to decentralized finance, it sounds like there's no central authority. So that means your crypto is asset-backed, right? Wrong. Bitcoin is actually negatively asset-backed. It uses up real resources, electricity, in order to create something that is a figment of your imagination. Decentralized finance is a highly risky sector, and such market cap figures can change rapidly. It is not a stable, guaranteed investment. There isn't even any kind of deposit insurance for your crypto, making it all the more risky. So, Mr. Sherlock, how is this decentralized finance safe? Wait, don't answer that. You have a bigger problem here, data oracles. Data oracles are inevitably exposed to hackers just like everything else. These hackers manipulate the market, causing price fluctuations well over 300% before they cash out with your money. Last year, $112 million was stolen instantaneously because a hacker was able to gain complete access to an oracle and manipulate its data to their advantage. I have to confess, every time you use the word token, I just can't stop laughing. On top of this, a lot of these are just jokes. Coins such as Garlic Coin, Trump Coin, Moon Coin, and even Doge Coin. Do these really sound like solid assets you want to hold?
Whoa, very funny. Aaron, don't talk about my Dogecoin that way.
Furthermore, Robert, you have over-exaggerated the impact of asset tokenization. It's still in its early stages, and the claim of a $3 billion market? Come on, for a picture of a monkey, the technology is simply laughable. And regarding the elephant in the room, it points to a serious underlying problem with crypto, the lack of security. Crypto is many things, a fad, a craze, but it is definitely not a currency. And this whole talk about blockchain, it sounds nice, but here's what it boils down to. It's a new technology that can be exploited and taken control of just like everything else. Most recently, a hacker stole $400 million from blockchain intel firm TRM Labs during the first 3 months of 2023. Why? Because the keys aren't secure. At the end of the day, Bitcoin is not a currency and blockchain is nothing new.
Thank you, Mr. Correll. Now on to the second question. Mr. Sherlock, is crypto a good investment?
Mr. Correll, what did you say? Only 1% of businesses accept crypto? You must be living in the metaverse. So you know, over 45% of merchants accept crypto, 75% of retailers will by next year, and transaction value will increase 160%. Now, to answer your question, Elon, of course crypto is a good investment. Name an asset that can beat these numbers. In October of 2023, Bitcoin had a 3-day return of over 15%. During the whole month of October, Bitcoin had a return of over 30%. And so far this year, crypto has made a return of over 100%. If you would have invested $100 into Bitcoin 10 years ago, you would have made a return of over 8,500%. That defines itself as a good investment. Mr. Correll, you must be in denial. Do you agree with me that the average stock return makes 10% a year?
Sure.
Okay. Let me be more specific. Over the last 5 years, S&P made 10%, Bitcoin made 40%. For the last 10 years, S&P made 9%, Bitcoin made 150%. Mr. Correll, how could you not see this? Anyways, the numbers speak for themselves, Mr. Correll, and I have not even started talking about blockchain applications. Blockchain is a large incentive to invest into crypto, and major companies are investing. Fidelity, Alphabet, BlackRock, Samsung, Morgan, Goldman, PayPal, and Visa are just some of the companies contributing to the $32 billion invested into blockchain investments since the beginning of 2022. Visa stated their customers have made $2.5 billion in crypto transactions in the first quarter of 2022 alone. Even governments are implementing blockchain technology, and countries such as Switzerland, Japan, Germany, Singapore, and Spain are adopting cryptocurrencies.
Thank you, Robert. By the way, you forgot to mention Tesla also invests in the blockchain. Anyways, Mr. Correll, your response.
You know what? That's a really good question. Thank you for asking, Elon. What I think is...
In terms of cryptocurrencies, I can say almost with certainty that they will come to a bad ending. Now, when it happens or how or anything else, I don't know, but I...
Well, I couldn't say it any better. Now, let me ask you a question, Robert. Do you still believe cryptocurrency is a good investment?
Of course.
Now, I won't insult your intelligence by suggesting you actually believe what you just said. But listen, here's what it comes down to. You cannot deflect attention away from crypto and onto blockchain. You keep saying the fundamental value of crypto is in the applications of blockchain, but that is simply not true. Because if it was, the price would remain stable, because blockchain isn't changing. Instead, cryptocurrencies are incredibly volatile and extremely susceptible to theft. Why? Because the value is not in the technology. The value is driven by speculative demand. And I must admire your selective memory, because in 2022, Bitcoin shed over half of its value in 3 months. And not to mention, scammers around the world took home a record $14 billion in cryptocurrency in 2021. Cryptocurrency theft has increased a whopping 500% from 2020. Recently, the Department of Justice seized $56 million in cryptocurrency scam investigation that was primarily funding terrorism and human trafficking. Is this really what you support, Robert? And after all this, you can't just say things and wish them true about blockchain. Here's the deal. You keep saying it's a good investment because of blockchain, but fundamentally, cryptos lack intrinsic value. Blockchain really isn't revolutionary, and it's already being implemented without the use of cryptocurrency. Right now, we are witnessing companies throw blockchain in their name just to watch the valuation of their companies skyrocket. Companies such as Global Blockchain Corp, Riot Blockchain, Blockchain Mining Limited, all of these are fundamentally worthless companies who haven't changed anything, but put blockchain in their name and watch the value of their stock prices skyrocket. It's speculative demand. And along with it, it's going to struggle to gain global acceptance. After all, India, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and China are just a couple of countries that have banned cryptocurrencies because they are speculative investments often related to criminal activity. So at the end of the day, here's what it comes down to: volatile returns, lack of global acceptance, and safety. Doesn't seem like a solid investment to me.
Is there a question or what was that?
Dr. Ma, before I answer your question, let me first respond to Mr. Carell's misleading claims. First, Aaron, it was you who exaggerated crypto's volatility. Crypto has long passed the growing pain of excess volatility. Last time crypto lost double-digit returns was back in COVID. As for the crypto lack of global acceptance, it is obvious Mr. Carell refused to acknowledge that in just this year alone, 56 countries have started significant campaigns in using crypto. Finally, the fact that you don't see the safety in the stablecoin is simply sad. Now, let's get back to Dr. Ma's question. First, I want to talk about the mining of Bitcoin. By now, everyone here knows there's a finite supply of Bitcoin at 21 million coins. In order for Bitcoin to be mined, computers must compete to solve complex mathematical equations. The first to complete succeeds. Every 4 years, the amount of Bitcoin able to be mined is cut in half. This is called a halving. This causes scarcity, driving up the demand, and driving up the price. The most recent halving took place in 2020, and the price of Bitcoin increased by 400%. I am telling you this because the next halving will occur in 2024. So now is the time to buy.
Thank you, Robert. Wow. I had not realized Bitcoin halving was right around the corner. Mr. Carell, on to you.
Where do I start? Let's start with the mining. Robert, do you realize in Texas, crypto miners use enough energy to power New York City 2.5 times over? Do you realize just to mine the two most popular coins, Bitcoin and Ethereum, it will take the entire UK's annual energy use? This is why states like Texas and New York were among the first to ban mining crypto. This is fundamentally not sustainable in the long term. Now let's talk about these so-called stable coins. This is what the European Central Bank had to say about them. High transaction fees, often called gas fees, are the additional price you pay to exchange between currencies. It's less cost effective, meaning depending on the time of day and the demand for your network, your fees could double or even triple. And they're still highly volatile when compared with money market funds. Now, finally, on to Bitcoin. Would you believe that these are the past 6 Bitcoin bubbles in the last 10 years? They all look the same. They rise 50%, then drop 50%. You do see this. Bitcoin prices can easily go up and down 50% within a week. But more importantly, we are at a point where we can easily see another 30% drop.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
If history can tell us anything.
You did it.
And Robert, you want us to buy now?
We still have another 30% of upside to go.
Thank you, Dr. Mom. Now, before I was rudely interrupted, I was saying there's a serious underlying problem with Bitcoin. There's a fixed amount in existence. That means once all of it is mined, the demand for Bitcoin will flatten out. The price will go down. This isn't sustainable. So whether you get your crypto through mining or other means, the fundamentals of it haven't changed. It is not a solid investment. And come to think of it, Robert, I'm just curious, but do you even have a crypto wallet?
Of course I do. Here it is. The more important question is, do you have one?
I asked you the question.
Oh, so you do have one? Unbelievable.
You guys can pay your internet bill, okay? Okay. You both need to give a 1 minute closing statement. Robert, go first.
Like it or not, crypto is mainstream. The fact that crypto has mirrored closely with the S&P and NASDAQ would tell us the world treats crypto just like another stock. Do you really believe that the stock market could continue to deliver 10% a year for the next 30 years, like the last 60 years? Do you really believe the bond market can continue to deliver 5% a year for the next 30 years, like the last 80 years? Crypto is the only asset that has produced 40% a year since inception. That is after only scratching just 5% of the surface. Just imagine what crypto investments can do for you for the next 50 years to come. Here comes Robert's Rules of 30s. Everyone under 30 years old should invest 30% of their retirement portfolio into crypto. You will make 30% a year for the next 30 years.
Thank you, Robert. Great way to finish. I enjoyed your new rule of 30s. Now, finish this thing off for us, Mr. Carell.
People are all the same. People never change. We simply chase bubbles. We have bubbles because of people like Robert. People will take out student loans to buy crypto. People will use their stimulus checks to buy meme coins. This is why we've seen 1637, tulip bubble, 1980, silver bubble, 1985, comic book bubble, 2001, dot-com bubble, 2007, housing bubble. Of course, crypto is no more different. In 2013, the first Bitcoin bubble burst, causing a 49% drop. In 2018, Bitcoin prices crashed 57% over a three-day period. In 2021, Bitcoin dropped 45% in 2 weeks. We will have more bubbles. I guarantee you, the next crypto bubble will burst before you know it. Why should it be any different this time? Okay, now it's Aaron's rule of 30s. For the next 30 years, we will see more than 30 bubbles, and each bubble burst will cost you more than 30%.
All right, that brings us to the end of the debate. I want to thank you both for participating and being civil. We want to thank the University of West Florida and its Argo Investment Program for having us. Thank you all for attending tonight. Thank you, and good night.
How about that? Okay, trustees, we will now begin the voting. All in favor of NVIDIA, please raise your hand. Four in favor, NVIDIA passes. All in favor of BYD, please raise your hand. Three in favor, BYD passes. All in favor of Kratos' defense, please raise your hand. One in favor, two in favor, three in favor. Kratos passes. Audience, it is now time for the popular vote. By following the instructions that are on the screen, please vote for the stock that you found most appealing. And before I release you to the food and refreshments, Dr. Ma would like to say something.
Oh, can you hear me? Good. Okay, for all my students, would you please stand up, please? Oh, okay, good. Ladies and gentlemen, I present you Argo Investment Program Class of 2023. Thank you.